We have Sandy Fletcher joining us. Sandy is the lead for EVA or spacewalking systems for Expedition 34. And we're really happy to have her here. Welcome.
Good morning. Thank you for having me.
Sandy, you've been working this week with the crew on orbit as they did some pre-planned procedures on cleaning the spacesuits or getting them ready so that they're always at the ready. It's part of something called the International Space Station Testbed for Analog Research. Can you explain a little bit about what that's all about for us?
Sure. It's learning what we can do for our next generation in space. And right now, the ISS is a great environment where we have a crew on orbit working and living in space. And we can learn from that experience. You know, we used to do shuttle flights, which were a couple weeks long. You know, they were very hectic, very fast-paced. You know, crew had a lot of things to do and a short time to do them in. Now we have guys living on orbit, men and women, for 6 months at a time, and we've got to learn how to do that. And what's nice is we have immediate comm with these guys. So if they have a question, they can call down right away and we can answer them right away. And we have data most of the time so we can watch over their shoulder. But when we start going out into further reaches, so when we go to the moon and Mars and maybe even asteroids, there's going to be a comm delay. And that means not only will they have to wait for answers via comm, but we won't be able to watch the data in real time. So just like the guys who drive the rovers on Mars, they have to send up a whole bunch of commands and then hope that they work. We have to rely on our astronauts to make sure that they can handle whatever happens nominally and off-nominally without as much help as we've been giving them in the past. So ISTAR, which is this ISS testbed for analog research, is trying to do that and mimic that so we can learn lessons while we still have data and comm with the crew, but see how they're going to react when they don't have us to talk with.
Okay. You mentioned communications delays. How long would those be if you're going to Mars or an asteroid?
They can be several minutes long. So we do need to have people being able to make a quick decision. If something goes wrong, do we have to save the system? Do we have to wait until somebody takes a look at it? Or is it a minor enough problem that they can handle it without any communication and assistance from us? And of course, these people are very smart, and we train them for 2 years before they fly. So, you know, they really don't need us for most things.
Well, so what specifically are you looking at in terms of these procedures for the spacesuits?
Normally, when we write procedures, we have the understanding that we'll be watching the data and have communications with them if they have questions. So a lot of the notes that we write in the procedures are really actually for us on mission control to remind us to do things. Now we're talking, and we're the systems experts. So, you know, whereas they study for 2 years to learn every system fairly well, we have the in-depth knowledge to understand. So we can be shorthanded with ourselves and our comments and know what we mean by them. Now imagine we hand these procedures to somebody who's not as familiar with them. We need to give them a little bit more depth and the ability to understand what's the next thing they need to do and why do they need to do it. So we do have to adjust our procedures that way.
So we're looking right now at some recorded video of Tom Marshburn. He was one of the crew members you've been working with this week. Can you explain a little bit about what he's doing here, what he's taking care of?
Sure. You can see we've got two spacesuits in the airlock. The helmets are off, so you can actually look inside the spacesuits. And periodically, when we don't use our EMUs for actual spacewalks, we do have to make sure that the systems are operating nominally, and that means we run the pump, which runs air, or really oxygen and water through the systems. We found, again, because we were actually doing it, we had a period of a couple years where we had suits on orbit and we didn't use them. And they got the water stagnated and then the pumps didn't work when we actually needed them to go out EVA. So we've learned that we've got to occasionally start them up just like you want to if you have a car. You can't let the car sit in the garage for too long. You have to make sure it runs. So we do the same thing with the suits. So that's what Tom is working on here.
And specifically, you did a cooling loop scrub, and you put in some additives to the cooling water, right?
That's correct. So part of the running the water through the system is we have filters in line. as the water stays stagnant in those lines, you know, it is contacting metal, so small particulates will come out. These components are very small, and so it really doesn't take a lot of contamination for them to seize up and stop working. So we filter the water for about an hour, and that filters them not only in the suits, but you can see the two connecting lines. We call them the service and cooling umbilicals. Those are the two white lines going back into the crew lock. And we also scrub the airlock heat exchanger. Then once we do that, we actually add iodine into the system. That'll run for about 2 hours, and that's to kill any organic or microbe growth that may be occurring.
Okay. Well, how did it all go?
Actually, it went extremely well. When I trained Tom Marshburn, you know, we had gone through this procedure, the version that we run here on the ground, and they run on orbit. And there were a lot of parts where we actually do the commanding on the ground. So I told him, oh, don't worry about this part. You won't have to do this in orbit. We'll watch the data, so we'll tell you if anything goes wrong. So I have to go and tell him, okay, we're going to do a little bit something different now. And he did a lot of complex commanding that they would not be expected to do normally. So actually that was the part that I was concerned about. Not that he couldn't do it, but it's not something that we typically train them to do. And he did a fantastic job, and we learned a lot from his experience going through it.
So what you're talking about is that there are steps in all these procedures that just call out for mission control, we'll do this now. But instead, now it calls out and said, Tom, you've got to go do this now.
That's right. And it's really quite a bit of difference between how we used to run things through Mercury and up through the shuttle lays. We had a lot of switches for crews to flip. We had fairly limited commanding from the ground to the vehicle. We relied very heavily on crew interaction with the systems to make it operate. Station is, ISS, the International Space Station, is very different in that sense because we want the crew to focus on doing science and experiments. So we do a lot more commanding from the ground and using computers. So in this case, we sort of went back to old school, if you will, and had Tom command the space station through the interfaces, the computers they have on board. And he probably sent more commands than most astronauts do on board.
Okay. Well, Sandy, tell us a little bit about yourself. Where are you from, and where'd you go to school, and how'd you get into the space business?
Well, I'm originally from northern New England, so Maine and New Hampshire, very rural areas, which are not necessarily hotbeds of space activity. And nobody I ever knew growing up was involved with the space industry, but I was just a little kid running around, like most kids are. And then I saw this movie called Star Wars, and that just, everything sort of came into focus, and I didn't know how I was going to do something like that, but I knew that's what I wanted to be involved with, just the excitement of space and traveling through space. And I have very supportive parents and family who never said, well, you can't do that, and they were very encouraging. And so I eventually went to school. I studied physics first at Wesleyan University, which is in Connecticut, and then the University of New Hampshire. I have a master's degree in physics.
Wow, interesting. Well, Sandy, thanks so much for being with us here today and explaining to us what ISTAR is all about and why crew members are having to do more work on board the space station. We look forward to hearing what the future might be for these kinds of procedures as we go farther and farther out into space. Thanks a lot.
Oh, thank you. I appreciate it.
That's Sandy Fletcher, the lead extravehicular unit engineer for the Expedition 34 crew here in Mission Control.